Hello, and you are very welcome to the first ever MAPA Music Podcast. The aim of this podcast is to highlight some of the great work that our students are doing during the current pandemic. First up, we have two very talented young producers, Malcolm Boyd and Míchéal McCay, discussing the latest single by Míchéal's music collective project, Hilo and the Tribes.
That is lovely to hear. Míchéal, I've got a couple of questions for you. Will you do me the honor of answering them pretty
quickly? Of course.
Thank you. Question one, Mr. McCay. Why did you choose this song to remix? That song being Teens Don't Write Diaries Anymore by Shanna.
Yeah, I think the kind of obvious and kind of the most honest reply would be because it sounds amazing. And I just thought I could present it in a different way. You know, it's not like it's already perfect. Like it's definitely already perfect. Mm. But I just wanted to, what inspired me was actually a comment in the YouTube comment section saying lo-fi banger. And I was like, yeah, no, that this song would totally work as like a, you know, lo-fi hip hop chill hop kind of production, like, and that, you know, just totally made sense to me. So
that's really cool. I didn't know that. That's so interesting. I don't know who made that comment. Who instigated this whole thing?
I'm not too sure, but I left a reply underneath the comments saying, like, you know, I remixed this because of this comment, so check it out and that kind of stuff. I don't know if he's responded to that or not, but
that's so cool. Aw, that's so cute. Míchéal, number two. Question number two. This is like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Once you answer this call, I'll give you guys time. Number two. Did you work with Shanna while doing the remix, or did you just kind of work on it yourself?
I kind of worked on it myself, yeah. I just kind of got permission to kind of remix her tune as part of the tech project.
Mm.
As part of the assignment, just. And then when I felt like I wanted to develop it into an actual release, then I kind of let her listen to it, and she really liked it. So yeah, she was on board with that, you know, so kind of naturally came about.
She's a very sweet individual, very easy to work with. Is that mm-hmm. She's definitely a wee sweetheart.
She is so sweet.
And she writes songs that make me cry.
Yes.
Míchéal, we're on to question number three. We're flying through this.
Wow. I might make it to the last question.
You might make it to the £5 yet.
Wow.
Maybe even a tenner. Question number three, Míchéal. Okay. Where did you start with the remixing process? What was the first thing that you like?
So, yeah, I mean, in the perfect world, like when I realized that I actually wanted to release this song, I probably would have gotten Shanna to record it, you know, re-record the vocal and the guitar and stuff. But because of what's going on in the world at the moment, that's not possible. So, yeah, I just had to use the audio from the video that she uploaded on YouTube. So I kind of took that. I found a tempo that kind of matched with it. I tapped out a tempo that went with it. And then I flex timed. I don't know if you do production at all, Malcolm, but so it kind of fits the grid of the tempo.
Yeah.
So yeah, I kind of went through the whole track, which took me, I don't know, maybe 15 minutes, 20 minutes or something. But it was well worth it. Like, but yeah, so I kind of put it to the grid of the tempo first, and then I assigned it to a keyboard, to a sampler. So each section, each kind of transient would be triggered by a different key on the keyboard. And I just started messing about with it, and I came up with that kind of intro slash hook of, like, you know, the hi ho that bit. Yeah, so it started with that, and then I kind of put a simple beat to it. And that's kind of where it started. Yeah,
thank you very much, Míchéal. I'm gonna finish this off now. You've won £5 million,
and yes,
although I can't legally give you the hug or the £5 million for tax reasons.
All right, well,
however, yeah. You have won me a distinction at Mark Egan. Give me a distinction.
Mark, you should do it. Mark,
please, I have a family,
please, Mark.
Right, I'm going to stop this recording now, and then the next section of the podcast is Joe Rogan. He's going to talk about hunting deer and how it affects your guitar tone. I have absolutely no idea how the two are linked, so I'm going to be very interested to hear this. Until then, until such a time as Joe Rogan enlightens us, I'm going to go watch Coronation Street, have a cup of tea. Thank you for listening.
And great. See
you later. You say under soft and delicate skies, I love it when it's creeping around the edges of your back and side. I know you're crazy, your color far more intricate than blue. You dare not show your colors off a woman, they say of you. Ceramic door, I know.
Sadie forever. Am I gonna do it with you? You get this devilish cut up in your lip that just can't be true. All my history, at a time I might have been paranoid. When I was just a little girl, wanted to be a little
was Aimee, Tourish and Malcolm Boyd, both from Donegal, performing a cover of the Wyvern Lingo song I Love You Sadie for this year's St. Patrick's Day Festival. Okay, so we have Cole McNicholl, a guitarist with Derry punk band Zabius, and he's here to talk about Inflammable Material by Stiff Little Fingers. So Cole, can you tell us who are Stiff Little Fingers?
Stiff Little Fingers were Irish punk band from Belfast. They started in 1977 during the Troubles, but they'd started off originally as just Deep Purple cover band called Highway Star after one of their songs. Then when they got into punk, they recorded 4 albums with the original lineup, got out of Belfast, and Bruce Foxton joined them at one point during the as the bass player for a good while as well.
And then, Bruce Foxton was the bass player with the Jam, is that correct?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
They're still playing today, with the original lineup now.
Didn't they play in the Bataclan? Was it the night after the Paris attacks, or was it the week after?
Yeah, they played in Paris not long after the attacks, because they were already originally scheduled to play, but because of how growing up in the Troubles, you know, bands were always getting their gigs cancelled because of a bomb threat or something. So that's why they decided to go ahead with the gig, because they wouldn't let that stop them, you know, because the promoter was looking to reschedule the gig. Jake Burns wouldn't have it because he grew up that way, you know, he didn't let that happen again.
Stiff Little Fingers they're famously anti-sectarian.
Oh, completely. Like, they've been asked a lot because of growing up in Belfast. They're always asked if they're a Catholic or a Protestant band. Jake Burns has always said, we don't take sides. Like, you know, we have both Catholics and Protestants in the band. They're not sectarian whatsoever.
And in 1975, they were calling for an alternative Ulster, which was very far-sighted of them, really, wasn't it?
Yeah. With songs like Alternative Ulster or Wasted Life, it shows how they truly felt, like, you know, that and how they just wanted to have a normal upbringing, like, you know, instead of all the sectarian violence at the time. I seen them 2 years ago, or yeah, 2 years ago now, up in Belfast, and in the Belfast 3, they had the Toy Dolls Therapy and Newmall Army supporting them.
Oh,
I went up to see them. I was 16, a skinhead at the time, like, and it was the best gig I've ever been to, like.
Brilliant. Well, what inspired the change to punk from Deep Purple covers?
Their bass player, Ali, you call him, he just came back from London when he joined the band, and he had brought a pile of records with him. In the records, you had Nevermind the Bollocks, Here's the Sex Pistols, or The Clash's first album, and they went through it, and they discovered punk, and that was it for them. Like, that was their new style, because they felt that a big part of it was England would have had, like, the fashion and all, and the music and all, but Ireland, especially at the time, had the reason for punk. Like, it was needed more than anything. They sat down, changed the name from Highway Star to The Fast. The record company wasn't fond of the name, so they sat and talked, and they came up with Stiff Little Fingers. It was named after a Vibrator song, and that's basically how they got into punk.
This year we began a podcast project with students from the International Business School, Mitrovica. In this segment, named Calling Kosovo, our students spoke with musicians Ema and Leon about life and music in Kosovo. The theme music for this podcast was the result of a musical collaboration between MAPA music students and the musicians from Kosovo.
Yeah, well, in Belgrade, the nightlife is very vivid and alive. Our electronic scene is very popular with us, and we have the genre turbo folk, if you heard of it. It's the phenomenon that happened during the 90s, during the war period. And it was something that became very, very much popular. It is the mixture of Serbian ethno music and disco music. So it's like the mixture of Serbian traditional sound and the other modern sounds and rhythms. So it is very much popular with the younger generations. And at one night, you can visit dozens of clubs that play that music. Also, I talk about electronic scene. It's very popular. The same thing you can hear at one night, the several major DJs performing, which is something huge for the country small as ours. So yeah, we have very vivid nightlife when it comes to music.
Here in Kosovo, and a little bit different from the Belgrade, as Emma said, we don't listen very much to electronic music, but about hip-hop, almost 80% of the population listen to hip-hop. So that's the reason why I'm in that genre, and I play hip-hop music, and R&B is very popular.
What artist would inspire you from your favorite genre?
Yes, I was just thinking.
Well,
I don't know that there are a lot of artists, but one particular person I investigate, even his personal life, which I never do, it's Tom York from Radiohead. So mm-hmm. His story and his philosophy really, really strike me. So maybe I would choose him, even though there are a lot of artists from a lot of different, I'm sorry, word,
sections. Genres.
Thank you. Really, really are important to me and my career, but I think I will choose Tom York, definitely.
Yeah, it's a great answer.
So can I answer the question? Even though I honestly don't know when it comes to Kosovo, I'm from Serbia and I'm studying in Kosovska Mitrovica, which is the Serbian part of Kosovo, which is very small. So the artists that that are listened to here are mostly from Serbia. So when it comes to Kosovo, I really don't have the answer. But when it comes to Serbia, mostly, like I mentioned, to turbo folk singers and artists are the most famous one. And it's I don't encourage it because it's a really bad scene in Serbia that we have in the field of culture in general. And those people are not good influences, but they are the most famous for sure.
Could I ask as well, can you give us a bit of background to the instrument you play and how you got there, Emma?
Yes, well, I study classical music since the age of seven. And I've been studying classical music my whole life, and it was the first genre of music that I was introduced into the music in general. That is the only genre I was introduced and taught in schools. So currently I'm at master studies for viola department in Faculty of Arts here in Kosovo. I played violin for like 15 years of my life, and then I transferred to viola because it's much more suiting to me. And I'm trying to perform as much as possible, but here it's very difficult to even organize events with classical music because a very number of people is actually interested in that and find it exciting to go to those kind of events. So yeah, that's my story when it comes to music.
Who would have inspired you in terms of a classical musician or a composer?
Well, maybe Robert Lakatos. He's from Hungary. Maybe the reason for this is because I had the opportunity to listen to him very young. And if you don't know who he is, he's very much stereotypical Hungary gypsy violinist, like small, fat, with mustache. And he played gypsy music. I mean, I was 10, maybe 11 at the time. And I still remember literally every note that he played because he put his entire soul and body to it. And that really struck me at that age. And I really decided that this is who I want to be when I grow up.
First, the big inspiration for me was one DJ from Kosovo, from here. He's not worldwide famous, but when I was younger, I used to work in my brother's business. It was a coffee bar, and we throw some party in the Fridays and Saturdays. And we used to call local DJ from Kosovo every Friday and Saturday. And I liked to watch them playing music every time. So there was my first steps in playing music. One DJ from Kosovo is my inspiration. His name is DJ Dugs. But one good DJ that you can know is DJ Regard. He's from Kosovo and he's famous worldwide right now. Maybe some of you can know him.
Yeah.
Good man, Ryan. Okay, so your first question there.
What are your plans for your futures in music?
For the future? I play music more for hobby, let's say, for fun, because I'm studying in economics and I'm not pretending to in some ways to live from music, but I think I always will play music just for fun. And also I earn something by doing this, so I like it. This is my plan for the future.
What about you, Emma?
Well, I'm actually not planning to be in the music and make money from the music, because I think it's really bad situation to even think about that. The most prosperity I have is just to teach in schools, and that's just not enough to get by in life. Financially. So that's why I enrolled in IBCM, because I want to try different things and actually try the career that will have some bigger impact on my life later on. And music is definitely something, yes, I will do my entire life, just not for like a job.
What do you all guys think for the music in the future?
I'm looking to go down a production role, work in recording studios and being a producer, or like in the studio. That's ideally what I want to be doing.
With what programming do you produce?
I've been using Logic this past while, been working away on it.
Ethan, what about you?
Well, I'll be looking to go on and do my, you know, degree, and then my master's, do my PGCE teaching certificate, and I'll be looking to, you know, do a bit of a mixed sort of career, like work in live music, work, you know, teach, and do a bit of composition and studio work as well.
Yeah, solid plan, dude. Emma, have you any questions for our crew?
Yeah, I wanted to ask, guys, what genre of music do you prefer to perform?
Okay, so which genre? Malcolm?
I don't have too much of a preference, because performing music live, whatever it is just like fun anyway. I would mainly enjoy kind of alt rock, I guess, but or funk. Funk's good crack as well. But anything that I get to play live, I enjoy thoroughly, because it's just fun to play music live.
Excellent. Cole?
My main one would be punk. Like, that, there's, like, the energy in it. Like, you know, it's, you get a real buzz off, like, when you're playing it live and all. Then, I love playing, like, you know, blues, like, rockabilly type of stuff as well. And some funk as well.
Excellent. Ethan?
I mainly play, you know, sort of hard rock, heavy metal, some blues and jazz. Those would be my preferred genres.
Deadly. Courtney?
I just like playing alternative rock too, like lots of stuff from the 90s and that kind of stuff.
Thanks to our two guests, Leon and Emma, all the way.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, cheers.
Take her easy.
Thank you.
I don't know you, but I want you all the more for that. Words fall through me and always fool me, and I can't react. Games that
suffered.
That was Falling Slowly, covered by Strabane singer-songwriter Juno Hasson.
Okay, so we've got Paul Atcheson, drummer with Holloway, and he is here to talk to us about the Bowron. So, Paul, can you tell us what is Bowron?
Well, the Bowron is also known as the Irish drum. It's a frame drum that's about 12 to 24 inches in diameter. It's usually made, or well, the body is usually made from hardwood or even plastic. The main head would have been used by goat skin, and however, nowadays it's made more of synthetic materials since they're easier to produce. But even now, you can still find Bowrons with different animal skins, and you can kind of find two different Bowrons nowadays. You have a tacked Bowron. This is where it's held. The head is held together with tacks, which means you can't actually tune it. And then there's the other one called the tunable Bowron, which has its head held by metal screws, which you can tighten and loosen to change the sound.
And what would your preference be?
I think the tunable one would be the best option because it just gives you more variety and just...
There's a much deeper resonance, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you come across the Seamus O'Kane Bowrons?
I actually have, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I was at a session one night and I heard one and I said, without even turning around, I said to my friend, I bet you that's a Seamus O'Kane Bowron. And it was. And, you know, that's how distinct sounding they are.
Yeah.
So can you tell us, what does Bowron mean?
Well, Bowron is a word that derives from the Irish word Bodhran, which means dull or deaf. And there's a debate that it could also mean skin tree, because there's a theory that originates from agriculture, but I'll get into that later. And it's just, the instrument has grown within Irish music since the 1960s, as well as other countries. So obviously it's going to have that kind of Celtic-inspired name and all the other sorts of it.
Brilliant. I didn't know that. That's fascinating. And how do you play the Bowron?
It kind of seems easy at first, because most people will just pick it up and just hit it with like the wee stick kind of thing, but it can be tricky at times. It requires coordination between your upper and lower body. And it also depends on what style being played as well. First, you have to balance the drum on your thigh, and then you support it with your upper body and your arm, whilst one hand is placed under the skin. This hand actually is also used for kind of tuning, because when you push against the skin, you can tighten or loosen it, which changes the pitch and timbre of it as well. This then, you hit it with the tipper, which is the stick, which produces the sound.
Excellent. And what are the origins of the Bowron?
As I said earlier, it's been kind of theorized that it comes from agriculture, but there is a disagreement and kind of a big enough debate on where the Bowron comes from. Some people believe the iconic one that we know today is actually rather a new variation of it. The evidence for this is backed by the sudden surge in that particular type of Bowron's popularity in the 1960s, when Sean Rita had that Celtic music revival kind of thing. And then, even if it wasn't a new variation, that was the big movement that made it popular outside of southwestern Ireland. But even at that, we know the original idea of the Bowron has been around for centuries. A theory proposed by Ronan Nolan, a journalist and editor for the Irish Music magazine, said that the Bowron was originally called the poor man's tambourine and was made from fire machines and added a head, as they didn't have any cymbals. No one believes it was popular around Ramboys in southwestern Ireland. To me, I think this probably wasn't the case, and they were probably just not rich enough to acquire an actual Bowron, and they just tried making their own. The evidence, I think, to back my claim is that there are ancient like canvases and stuff, especially one here by Dan McLeese, who lived between 1806 and 1870, and he has a canvas that shows someone playing a Bowron at a Halloween festival, although he's played it without a tipper, so he's just playing it like a normal drum kind of thing. And then writers also believe it comes from North Africa and made its way to Ireland as they travel through Spain. And then there's another one whose name is Henry Gigerty, and he says him and many other people support the idea it came from Central Asia and was carried by Celtic migrants through Europe and then eventually to Ireland.
Great stuff, Paul. That was brilliant. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name's Megan Morton, and this is my original song, Bubble Wrap Babe.
Bubble
Okay, so we have Juno Hasson, singer, songwriter. Juno, can you tell us a little bit about your vocal technique, please?
Yeah, I've come a long way. I remember when I was younger, I absolutely used to sing from my throat, which is, that's the first thing I'll start with, is the worst thing you can do for your voice is to sing from your throat or from your nose, because it's you're not supporting fully. So I think the most important thing for me in technique is support, and not just support on like lower or higher notes. I feel like, you know, and it is a very important point when people say when you're singing, you know, higher notes or belts or things like that, you need to use your diaphragm, and you do. But I feel like people forget to support even your mid notes and everything, but just constantly. And if you want to think about it in like a form of physicality, when you're doing a sit-up and you feel like, you know, you can feel your abdomen kind of tensing a bit, that's basically what it should feel like. It's just support coming from your diaphragm and opening your mouth. I can't stress enough about opening your mouth and having your tongue lying flat and having a relaxed jaw. All of that, if you're not supporting from your diaphragm other than your throat, you're going to cause tension. It's going to strain your vocal cords. It's going to stress them out, and it's going to tear them. That's what happens when you support from your throat. And always, always, always have a loose jaw, because, again, tension. And tension's the worst thing for your throat. In terms of keeping it healthy as well, because, like, even, you know, even the singers with the best technique, you know you're gonna get sick, or sometimes your voice just gets tired. That's how it is. You can't avoid it. It's just how it is. Drink lots and lots of water. I can't say to avoid caffeine or like spicy foods, because, you know, it's unrealistic to deprive yourself of stuff like that. You know, it is everything in moderation. But like, for example, if I had a gig maybe 24 to 48 hours before, I would try and eat proper, you know, lots of veg, lots of fruit, honey, ginger and lemon tea. Drink as much water as you possibly can. If you're not a big water drinker, it'll change your life, honestly. Drinking water changed how I sang, and drinking so much of it. And make sure to warm up. Again, the three biggest things are support from your diaphragm, relax your jaw, sorry, drink water, and what did I say there now?
And warming up.
Thank you.
Which actually brings me on to me. So could you give us maybe an example of a vocal exercise you would use to warm up before a gig?
Oh, God. My vocal warm-ups are like cats being dragged on a blackboard. It really isn't. They're really not nice ones. It is really ones to, like, try and get your... just to try and properly warm up your voice. I always find that, like, lip rolls are really good. Arpeggios are actually really, really good. And if you can do sirens as well. And another thing, I feel like this isn't something that's talked about a lot in vocal warm-ups, and it's something that I used to do when I was younger, when I thought I was really, really cool. But whenever you're warming up and you're, you know, you're going from low to high and you're doing all these skins and everything, I used to like try and belt the really, really high notes. But that's, warming up isn't about like showing off. Warming up is literally just about getting your voice used to singing and stuff, and making it a bit more awake, because your voice will comply and it will happen if you support. But if you go too hard in your warm up, it's going to be harder to sing later on, if you know what I mean.
Is it essentially like an athlete stretching before?
It absolutely is. Your vocal cords are a muscle. You'd never see an athlete just be like, I'm just going to run. I'm just going to run a marathon. It's not something that happens. It's, if you don't warm up, you are, every time you don't warm up and you sing, you're damaging your voice. And like, I can be completely honest, I've been a culprit of it. When I was younger, I did not take care of my voice. I didn't do any of the steps. And I seen a change. I was like, this is getting harder and harder. But then probably around 17, when I thought, well, do you know what? I did drop out of school to do music. Maybe I'll start taking care of my voice. the noticeable difference in like control, vibrato, everything like that, like tuning, resonance, everything, once you start warming up and warming down. And it doesn't have to be like extreme. It can just be a couple of lip rolls. It can just be a couple of like arpeggios. But if you warm up every day, you're strengthening your muscles like every time. That's what I'd like athletes, like say for example, I don't know, like Chris Hemsworth, when he was going to do Thor, he didn't just like do stunt work and not prepare. He built up muscle, he built up strength, and that's how he got to where he is. It's the same with your voice. You build up strength and you build up resistance, and that's how your voice becomes strong and healthy.
As part of our musicology module, we invited musician Quincy Dugan to chat with our students about marching bands, Orange Identity, and music in Northern Ireland.
I was just wondering, have you ever like experienced any kind of conflict or anything through the music that you play?
Well, like I'm 30, I'm 46, so this Chelsea, is it? I have, you know, first of all, there's two ways I suppose you could look at that and answer that. I have been at many a parade dispute over the years, from Pomeroy to Katy to throughout Belfast and Portadown, Armagh, and you know, it's in terms of the actual music. It used to be you would have heard it said quite often, oh, that music's offensive, that music's offensive. And now, that argument was always blatantly crap. It was pish. Music is just music. Music cannot be intrinsically offensive. The performers can be. The words of a music could be, accompanied by music, could be offensive. But the simple music can't be offensive. We did hear that an awful lot. At one point, I remember there was a parade dispute in the Ormo Road a long time ago, and my band happened to be involved with participating in that event because of an Orange relationship with that Balnafay area. And the next morning, there had been trouble at it, and the next morning they were talking about this trouble, and there was an image, video image of my band walking down the Ormo Road and a mini rat going on. And they were talking about this music and all, blah, blah, blah. Now, it was a great indicator, because that tune, we called it Sandy Row, okay? And was one of the main tunes we play. But that tune is played by every Republican flute band, and it's better known as the Wearing of the Green. You know, it's just... You know, and there's other secular movements play that tune as well, you know. So there's something. Other forms of conflict. It's wonderful how in the band room how banal this becomes. You know, it really loses all the politicization altogether. You know, the way we would sort our repertoire was there's usually three or four guys that would bring a new tune up. They'd write a new tune out and bring it up to the hall. You know, and there'd have been, people would have been rhyme because, and I don't like that, but I do like that. But that doesn't work right with the drums. We need to change the drum, and well, I don't want to play it at all, you know, and that's a different sort of conflict, but that existed.
Thank you. That was the Congress Reel and the Mason's Apron, played by Aaron O'Brien.
We've Courtney Kennedy here, and she's going to talk a little bit about grunge. So, Courtney, where did grunge originate from?
Well, basically, Mark, grunge originated in around Washington in the mid to late 80s. You had like bands that were starting to come around, and they were inspired by bands like the Pixies and Sonic Youth and stuff. And there was just like a real influx of bands that kind of all had this similar sound. And the first person to actually use the term grunge was Mark Arm from Mudhoney. And ever since he said that, the term just kind of stuck.
So how did grunge become so popular?
Well, then in the early 90s, like around 1991 and 1992, you just had all these bands that were releasing these albums then off major records. You know, they had off major record labels, like, and so suppose the album that made it so popular first was Nevermind by Nirvana. That album actually knocked Michael Jackson off the charts at the time for the number one spot. And then, you know, we had Pearl Jam released 10 as well, which was really popular. And Soundgarden came out with Bad Motorfinger. They're kind of the albums that made grunge really popular. I suppose grunge was popular then because, you know, there's a whole fashion thing that came along with it too.
I have to say, Bad Motorfinger is one of my favorite albums of all time. You know, Rusty Cage, Slaves and Bulldozers. And what about grunge today?
Today, I wouldn't say that there are any grunge bands. I think grunge really did kind of die whenever Kurt Cobain died. You know, obviously, you still had those bands. The other grunge bands would still release albums and stuff, but it definitely was never as popular again after the demise of Nirvana. And then you had post-grunge in the early 2000s with bands like Creed and Nickelback, but I don't like post-grunge at all. I think it was terrible.
Strange
That was Someone New, the Hozier song, performed by Aimee, Malcolm and Paul.
And now we've Noel Shevlin, a singer-songwriter from Downings in Donegal. And Noel, you gave us a lovely rendition of Paddy's Green Shamrock Shore for the St. Patrick's Day Festival. Can you tell us a little bit about that tune?
I've always kind of been a, you know, big Paul Brady fan, and my brother and myself would always kind of listen to him, and we'd be listening to the island, Lakes of Pontchartrain, but kind of Paddy's Green Shamrock Shore would always kind of be her favourite, and I just think like it's such a great song, and like it, and Paul Brady like really, he kind of really sells it. I think he's a storyteller, and you know, he brings you back to old Ireland and, you know, what it was like years ago. And it's just so interesting, like, as I said, because, like, you know, obviously, like, we weren't there years ago, but it kind of makes you picture, if you know what I mean. Like, he tells you the story about it. And I just think it's a great song. Like, and where I heard it, brother Rory, he was listening to it on his phone. As I said, like, we're big Paul Brady fans, like, and he was listening to it on his phone, and he showed me, and he said, "Noel, you know, you'd sound well singing this song." And when I first heard it, then like I just instantly fell in love with it. Like, it was just, as I said, like, just such a good song, like, from years ago, and you know.
Brilliant. So, would you do us the honour of introducing your song first, please?
Yeah, this is me singing Paddy's Green Shamrock Shore. Thank you.
From Derry, K, we sailed away on the 23rd of May. We were boarded by a pleasant crew bound for America. Fresh water that they did take on 5,000 gallons or more. In case we run short, going to New York, far away from the shining shore. Well, we sailed 3 days, we were all seasick, not a man aboard was free. We're all confined into our bunks, with no one to penny poor me. Taking his passengers by a
And next up, we've Daniel Geller, singer, guitarist with the Diplomats, and he's here to talk about the Beatles. And I think specifically Strawberry Fields. Is that right, Daniel?
It is, yeah.
Yeah, great stuff. So tell us, how did John Lennon come up with Strawberry Fields?
So John Lennon writ the song Strawberry Fields Forever, and he was actually in Spain at the time. He was appearing on Dick Lester's comedy movie, How I Won the War. And he, I suppose, was getting a bit sentimental. He was missing home. He was missing Liverpool. And he was reminiscing on the times of being in Strawberry Fields in Liverpool. And there was a Salvation Army home where he used to attend garden parties with his neighbours' friends. And they were very fond memories he had as a child. And he also remembered being quite disillusioned as a child because he was always very different from, you know, his friends and his peers. And he always felt that he was sort of overlooked, and teachers would always, you know, be kind of getting on to him, you know, about, you know, they couldn't understand why he wanted to be a musician. And they always told him, oh, you know, you need to be a doctor, you need to be a dentist. So I guess he kind of wrote the song in one way, thinking about home and reminiscing about his fond memories as a childhood, but also his feelings of disillusion and just not fitting into the crowd, I guess.
Great stuff. I know. It's quite interesting how he came up with that. And can you tell us how the track was recorded?
So the recording stage of the track is very interesting to me. I actually only learned about this maybe about a year or two ago. To me, it perfectly sums up the type of person John Lennon was. He was very experimental and a bit of a perfectionist, but he made 26 different versions of this song. The demo, which was obviously the first version, was in C major and was 83 BPM. And it was quite a folk kind of oriented track. Around this time, he was very influenced by Bob Dylan and what Bob Dylan was doing at this time. And I guess he wanted to try and incorporate some of Bob Dylan's ideas, but he quickly kind of went away from that then. And the second version was recorded in C major, but it was 55 cent flat. And the reason for this was they were messing around with fairy speed at this time. It was one of the new technologies in the studios. So they kind of recorded the track and then they were speeding it up and slowing it down. And as a result, they changed the keys and the pitches and the tempos of the song. So the first version was in C major. Then another version is in B flat major and it's 25 cent flat and it's at 90 BPM. Then version 7 is in B flat major and is 57 cent flat at 90 BPM. And then the final version, which is version 26, is in concert C major and was 111 BPM. So John Lennon had settled on this version 26, which was in C major and 111 BPM. Now, I've listened to all of these, and to be honest, in my opinion, it sounded terrible. It was way too fast, and John Lennon just sounded terrible on it, but for some reason he liked it. But they went back then and they listened, and he also liked the version 7, which is in B flat major. So he went to George Martin, the producer, and he told him that he liked both the versions. And of course, George Martin said, you know, well, we can't have both. And he said, well, why can't we? You know, we've used this fairy speed, you know, we could try and use it to merge the two together. So George Martin went ahead and they first of all slowed down the version 26, and it was slowed to 99 BPM, and they slightly sped up the version 7. One, it was at 90 BPM originally, and it was sped up slightly to 91 BPM. And they managed to merge the two because there's a certain point in the song where it kind of comes to a pause, and they used a sort of effect. It's nearly like when you use a slide on the guitar, and it slides in to this other version then, which is at 99 BPM. Now, it's amazing when you listen to the song. Like, I never noticed it. But if you listen very carefully, you will notice in between. I'm not quite sure. It's one of the verses anyway. And you can notice then that the slightly faster version kind of fades in then. So, yeah, I found that really interesting.
Oh, yeah, that's fascinating. I never knew any of that. That's brilliant. We probably won't be able to unhear that now, Daniel. So,
yeah.
How did the song perform in the charts?
So, for the release, yeah, the Beatles planned to issue Strawberry Fields along with Penny Lane as part of the next album, which would have been the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club album. But EMI asked for a single in 67. So both the songs was issued as singles, and Penny Lane was the A side. And Penny Lane performed better, actually reaching number 2, whereas Strawberry Fields only charted at number 8.
Thank you for listening. See you next semester.